I actually, yeah, I do know.
Seeley has all answers.
But it's just, it's the Al Ewing series, but it's just regular old school Hulk, like big, you know, big brow, regular old
big cerebral
Hulk.
Ridge.
Yeah, that Hulk.
Okay, it's just a Hulk, basically.
Yeah, see, I see Hulk. Cerebral Ridge. Seeley says that Hulk.
Yeah, you know, one of the, that Hulk. The one we all know, that old Hulk.
There you go.
This is the Great Legend. I'm coming at you live. Welcome to Baltimore Comic-Con. And we've got a great show for you tonight because we have the Hero Initiative Drink and Draw for 2020. And this is like one you've never seen before because we're doing it virtually. Man, we're so excited to have you here. We have 10 of the premier artists. They are our all-stars for Hero Initiative. And this is sponsored by Wiggly Whiskey out there in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, where they make some of the finest whiskey and finest spirits in all of PA. And I'm going to get to our all-stars tonight. We have first up, we got Dan Brereton. What's up, Dan?
Not much. I'm almost done with my first card.
Let's see that card real quick.
It's probably back.
Oh, that's right. Nice. Crypt Keeper. Love it.
Crypt Keeper. Right. Freaking classic. Next up, we have Becky. Becky Cloonan, how are you doing tonight?
Good, hey.
What are you working on right now, Becky?
I'm some Firestorm right now. And I have, it's actual gold. I don't know if you can see it, real gold.
That is beautiful, nice. Becky. That's awesome. That dude's got that gold head of flames. Next up, we have Sean Forney. Sean, what's happening?
How's it going? Drawing Wolverine here.
Sweet, dude. I love me some Wolverine. Next up, we have Sanford Greene. Sanford, Hello. How are you doing, sir?
I'm good. I'm actually working on Brother Voodoo right now. And
that's awesome, dude.
Along pretty nice, man.
Freaking awesome. We have next up Megan Hutchison. Megan, how are you tonight?
I'm good. I actually think I'm done with my first one. I did Jack and Sally.
Oh, wow.
They're in love.
Awesome.
The movie is problematic, but they're a really cute couple.
That's awesome, Megan. Next,
it's 2020 in a nutshell. Problematic, but somehow cute.
Yes. Good one. I like that.
Christmas may turn out to be that way. You never know. Daniel Warren Johnson. Daniel, how you doing, sir?
Hey, everybody. I just finished Spider-Man ruminating on his Sony A6400 camera.
Nice.
You are ridiculous.
Next, we have Tony Parker. Tony, how you doing?
Doing well. How y'all doing?
Doing great. What do you got drawing there?
I just wrapped up my Beta Ray Bill.
Oh, yeah. Beta Ray.
Put it out there. Couldn't do it without Stormbreaker, so put them all together.
Mm-hmm. That's beautiful, my friend.
Oh, Beta Ray.
Beta Ray, total classic. Tony Parker, we just went to you, Beta Ray Bill. Sorry about that. Reading your name twice because it's just as nice. Next up, Absolutely. We got Tom Raney. Tom, what's going on? There's Tom.
Medusa.
That's right. We were talking earlier.
There it is.
There's Medusa. Got some of the best powers. One of my favorite of the Inhumans. A huge Fantastic Four fan. Huge Inhumans fan. The awesome.
He's a lot of fun.
Tim Seeley. Tim, how are you doing this evening?
Good. Hey, good to see you guys. Let's see. I'm working on a couple. I did this one, which is the Megan Fox, Jennifer's Body going. Mm-hmm. And I'm starting on a Mystique. I got all the ladies today, which I'm totally good with. So
Hell
thank
yeah.
you for requesting the ladies.
Mm-hmm. And we have Terry Moore. Terry, how's it going?
It's me. Pretty good. I'm glad to be here. Glad to be back in Baltimore.
Heck yeah. Now, sadly, Ryan Stegman couldn't make it this evening, but have no fear. He's going to be along for the ride tomorrow with Donny Cates as they talk about a special book. And I'm not even going to let you know, but a lot of you do. It is the king. So I'm just going to leave it at the king.
Well, hi there, everybody. Donny
Hey, whoa! Here.
I thought I'd crash this just a little bit. I'm not going to take up too much time. Just wanted to stop and say hi. I have to admit, I'm a little bit starstruck. Terry Moore is here. Thank you. My God. Terry, hi. We've met a few times. Donny Cates, I'm such an incredible fan of your work, man. Such a huge inspiration to me. I'm honestly kind of nervous, like shell shocked.
Okay, you're back in the will.
Terry, you're in Texas, aren't you?
Yeah, Houston.
You're in Houston? Oh, okay. I'm sorry to hear that.
Yeah, me too.
We're in Austin, so we're like out in the hills and everything. But are you a native Texan?
Yeah, I was born in Texas and then immediately left and lived overseas a bunch of places and then came back.
Yeah.
So are you a native Texan?
Yes, sir, I am. I was born in Dallas. I grew up in Garland. Do you know Garland?
Yes. I went to high school in Richardson.
Did you? Really? Oh, yeah. My God. That's bananas, man.
Bananas.
Well, I can never go back.
I got to say, man, about once a year, I do an entire Strangers in Paradise reread. And I have to say, it's so odd to me. So much of my work at Marvel and stuff is known for this, like, big bombastic action stuff. But where my true inspirations lie is like stuff like Strangers in Paradise. And I every chance I get, I try and kind of impersonate you in a very poor and not as good way, not as eloquent way that you do. So.
Oh, you're very kind. Thank you. You could start by shaving your head. The hair's not gonna work.
Hey, on Twitter the other day, you tweeted out, I'm sorry for hijacking your stream, I'm just nerding out because Terry's here. On Twitter the other day, you put up the idea that you might reprint the Strangers in Paradise, that first shirt that you did.
Yeah.
Please let me know. I would buy the hell out of that.
I would sell it to you for half price.
I would pay double price, Terry. I won't take up too much of Meg's time here. Who else we got on this?
Donnie, say nice things about me now.
Wait, who's talking? Oh, Daniel, hi.
I want to be next.
I feel left out now.
Well, it's like a reverse roast. It's just Donnie says nice things about you.
Artist egos, they're so much fun to watch. So much fun.
Oh, God. Becky, we miss you, man.
I miss you too.
For those of you who don't know, Becky and Michael and Meg and I live maybe 10 miles from each other, but never see each other because of, well, I was going to say because of COVID, but even before COVID, we were all so terrible about meeting up. Who else we got here? Is that Sanford?
Yeah.
Donnie hijacked.
Hey, buddy. How you doing, man? Hey.
I think I need to unmute to say hello to you, so hello.
Hey, how you doing, man? Hey, congratulations so much on all your success, man. I'm so proud of you. I think the last show that I was ever at was C2E2, where you and I got to kind of catch up in the lobby and stuff, man.
Right. I tell you what, man. Who was able to get to C2E2? Anyone here?
Yeah,
I was
last show of the year.
Yeah, no, I didn't. I was this close to saying I'm not going to go to it. The schedule was too crazy, but my God, I'm glad I went to that show.
Right, I know. I honestly like it, when I was in C2E2, like properly, I was like, man, whatever, like another C2E2, whatever. But looking back on it now, it's like Valhalla. You know, I was like, man. I actually had a conversation with people like a foot away from them, and I got to hug human beings, you know?
Right. Yeah, we won't see that for another year.
Maybe. When I think of all the times that I've stood at a table and talked to somebody and their spit is hitting my face.
Yeah. Hey, Sanford, are you able to is any more info about the big thing? Is there any more stuff you can share about?
You don't see them do this.
Boy, you really have hijacked this
I'm not trying to. You're all artists. You're all just drawing. When I walked in here, you were all quiet.
What What thing? Are you talking about the film?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, there's a few things. I mean, COVID has slowed things down, obviously. But we had a meeting about 2 weeks ago, actually. Boy, you really put me on the spot here.
I know. I'm sorry. I know. I've been seeing you guys for a long time, man. Sorry.
Nah, it's good. I mean, we're actually having conversations. I guess I can share this. The executive from Legendary.
Yeah.
She sent us a personal email congratulating us on everything, and she says she looks forward to seeing this film come to fruition. And so she the one that pulls the purse strings. She has the
who, Mary?
Over at Legendary. Yeah.
Mary?
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah. But yeah, she cashes the checks. So
nice, man.
Yeah, man.
I'm really excited for you, man. I know you shared with me at C2E2 some shit that I shouldn't repeat. But super excited for you guys, man.
Yes, sir. Yeah, and I guess we'll, I don't know. I guess once the beginning of the year, hopefully there'll be a little more of a solid direction.
Yeah, yeah. That's kind of the same thing it's been on God Country is, the COVID stuff.
Yeah.
Put a wrench in the everything.
Everything will be filmed in New Zealand. So,
it's funny you say that. Is the director that we signed on for God Country is in New Zealand filming something else? And man, when he talks about New Zealand, it sounds like paradise. Like, they don't have any cases, and people can just like go to lunch and hang out and like hug people and stuff. And just like that's so foreign and bizarre,
Before COVID, New Zealand was a paradise.
Well, absolutely. Becky, did I ever tell you my really embarrassing story about when I was in Australia?
No.
Okay, so Meg and I are in Australia for a show. And you know how when you guys go to shows, especially overseas, they just kind of clump all of, they don't really care if it's like comic book folks or actors and stuff. They just like kind of clump you all together and go sightseeing, And so Meg and I found ourselves at this nature preserve with Elijah Wood. And Elijah Wood, just the sweetest dude in the world. And he was flipping out. Like, dude, you should have seen him.
He loved birds.
He loved birds so much. He would like walk around and be like, "You guys, look at these birds." And I'm like, those are some cool birds, bro. I don't know. And then, so we got this shooting the shit, right? And I was just kind of not paying attention to the words that come out of my mouth, like usual. And, I was asking Elijah, I was like, "Hey man, so what are your, travel plans this next year?" And he was telling me his, and then I said to him, I was like, "Yeah, Meg and I, and we were going to go, but COVID," I was like, "Yeah, we're about to go to New Zealand. We're really excited." And he was like, "Oh man, you're going to love it." And I was like, "Oh, for real? Have you been?" I know. Oh, nice. He looked at me and was like, yeah, a little bit. And I was like, "Oh fuck, that's right. You're fucking Frodo. God damn it."
Fucking Frodo.
Hey, what are you guys drawing? Is there a prompt or
request?
No, wait.
So for the people that's bottle,
you guys got to hear some of these prompts that I got here.
For the people that did
Luke inside X-wing in a profile shot with another ship in the background.
Wow,
dude, that poster.
Daniel, you did this to yourself.
Yeah. Dude, I find it adorable hearing Daniel talk about, "Oh, a challenging commission." It's like, dude, come relax.
Yeah. Well, here's another one. Miles Morales at a protest.
I mean, I
like that one.
That's super in character.
I feel like. Oh, totally. I gotta figure out how to fit a crowd scene on this coaster.
our sponsor.
Again, listen to Dan Johnson be like, how can I fit this into this? It's like, Dan,
look at this coaster.
The commissions that you get, go get a commission. It's okay. Like, I want to see Beta Ray Bill holding a hammer, and you're like, all right, here's that, but here's 50,000 like warriors in the background, and they're all, you know, whatever.
Okay. That's it. I'm starting over.
Hey,
I was in the other room, and I could hear Donnie loudly chastising a bunch of people who are drawing.
I'm which not is so,
that's such a fucking writer move.
No, not at all.
I came into the room and I was like, is that fucking Donnie? Hutchison was a drink and drop. Donnie's just drinking.
Hey, no, next time we can have a drink, do a drink and write. Maybe next time we'll be drinking right, starring Donny Cates and nine other writers.
That's just
Donnie was talking a red streak.
No,
I'm trying to play a little Warzone.
You in so long, and I'm over here watching Meg talk to you guys, and I'm just like, oh man, I want to talk to my friends. Fucking Timmy Seeley is on here. How you doing, buddy?
Daddy. Good to see you, brother.
Yo, Terry, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
I see a guitar amp back there. Do you play guitar?
Oh yeah, I've been playing since I was 12.
That's awesome.
Everybody my age plays guitar.
The chat would like to see you play.
Terry, have you heard Dan play?
No.
He's unbelievable. Mm-hmm.
Really?
Not that good.
Oh my
no,
God.
I'm not. No.
It's phenomenal.
So I got a phone call a little bit ago from our sponsor. They want to apologize to those people that did their bottles didn't or their gifts didn't arrive.
So well, I forgive.
We're resending, and Megan, we're resending you and your significant other.
Okay.
I thought you sent it media mail, and I thought that was just a bad way to send it.
I'm sorry. I just have to nerd out about guitar stuff for just like two more minutes.
Yeah.
What's your like number one axe, Terry?
Oh man, I got it right here. Hang on.
Let me see this.
Nice. Okay.
Hey, I have to say while Terry's doing this. When I was a little kid, when I was going to cons, the first con sketch I ever got from a professional, I waited in line for a very long time. And the first sketch I ever got was an awesome Batman that I still have to this day, drawn by a one Mr. Tom Raney.
Oh, wow.
Really?
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. It's like one of my, literally the first one ever. And I still have it, man.
Well, I hope I did a good job on it.
You did. You did a phenomenal job. And you were very sweet to a young, whatever, like 14-year-old me. So it's nice to see you, man.
And look at how you turned out. Well, like, it's great.
The work in progress.
That's a nice way of putting it.
I think Donnie is setting up a imprint, and he's going to send us all an email here right after this Zoom.
That right? Yeah, this is me buttering you all up.
You're poaching the talent as we speak.
It's not a bad idea.
It is not a bad idea. Actually.
All right, Terry, give it to me. Give it to me.
Let's hear a jam session.
Ooh.
Oh. What year is that?
It's a custom shop 1960 plain top.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
I had
God.
A curly top, but then I thought. I don't ever want to walk into a really store with a fancy curly.
No, the joke is that.
Yeah, that's fair. That's
I think I've heard that joke with Viola's.
Yeah.
But then I got this other thing. I wanted a top body.
Yeah.
And now I'm really loving this one.
Oh, that's
gorgeous. Ooh,
gorgeous.
Dude.
A PRS?
Yeah, a PRS.
Hell yeah.
It's completely hollow.
Why aren't we just doing a jam session? Put down your pencils, boys. Dan, fired up. I'll get my drum set out.
So, what kind of frets are on that hollow body?
They look like 6105s.
Okay.
So okay, the same nice. As the Gibson Custom Shop. So dude. It's good. I mean, and I have to tell you that I think it's better than the Les Paul.
Really?
Yeah. And I thought the Les Paul was the best one I'd ever played because I've had about six of them over my lifetime.
That's awesome.
But, and I actually had a 54 one time.
Really?
Yeah. It actually wasn't that good.
Yeah, not all vintage guitars are amazing.
Not all of them are good. I mean, some of them are just bad furniture that was, you know, left in the rain or something.
Dan, what do you play on?
Well, I have a Gibson SG that my dad gifted me when I was in college, which I still have, which is probably the guitar that's like closest to my heart. But the guitar I play most, one sec. Yeah.
I love all this.
Oh my God, Tony Parker's here. Oh, wow. Hey.
So, okay, so this is a 1988 Jackson Custom Shop.
Wow, look at that.
So with a reverse headstock. It's an SL1. It's a soloist model. So it's a neck through construction. So there's like, you know, that solid piece of wood that's, you know, the neck all the way down to the butt of the body.
Right.
With the horns, you know, built on the side. And, you know, it has Grover Jackson's initials on here. Really? Yeah, it was this was built in Ontario when they moved from somewhere else in California to Ontario, call it California. I don't know where they started, but
1988. That looks like something Stevie Vai would play.
Yeah, I have a Ibanez RG550 reissue upstairs that I play a lot.
Are you a shredder?
I mean,
he's a fucking shredder. Terry.
People in the chat want to see y'all shred some guitar together, a la Crossroads style. Yeah. Give us your best Ralph Macchio.
Bet on your souls.
Yeah.
Terry, sincerely, if you go to Dan's Instagram page, he fucking shreds, man. Like guys, like he's only slightly a better artist than he is a guitar player.
Jeez.
Which is saying something.
Sometimes I wonder, so many artists are musicians as well, and I don't know if they're out-of-work musicians or if musicians are out-of-work artists.
Yeah, who else is a Capullo's a big guitar player and collector as well.
Yeah, right? He is.
Yeah. The guy that used to run Capital City Distribution, he was a guitar player.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, it's just everybody, I think, over a certain age just grew up with it.
Oh, look, Sean's breaking
out. Sean's pulling out a guitar.
You got like a Zach Wilde.
Zach Wilde.
Yeah, so my wife went and dug it out. It's my Kramer 1984.
That's beautiful.
Thank you.
That's serious.
So the chat's wanting all of y'all to play, and they want Donnie on the skins.
I can do it. There's like when you're making like Instagram videos and stuff, it's so easy for you to sit in front with a guitar and stuff, but there's no one wants to see me sit down on my drum kit fucking and blow out mics playing. Although it is, Dan Johnson and I have known each other for over a decade now, right, Dan?
Since 2013. So almost.
Right. Yeah. And we have been talking about for a million years, trying somehow to get in the same room because I'm a big metal drummer. So double bass, you know, blast beats, stuff like that. And I just, it's bizarre that Dan and I have never been able to figure it out, but someday.
My favorite metal band is Nevermore.
Oh, Nevermore's great. Yeah. I'm a little bit I'm a Pantera, Lamb of God kind of a, you
wow.
know. Yeah, kind
That's
of.
That's a sweat machine.
It is.
You never stop.
Pantera, every year by year, becomes more problematic to be able to enjoy. But I like to pretend that, because with Pantera, the problem is that only the shittiest one is still alive. You know, like it's such a fucking drag that the worst one of them is still alive. So I like to pretend that they all went out in a blaze of glory, and I'm just stick to the straight Pantera and not veer off, you know. So anyway, hey, I'm so sorry guys. I didn't mean to hijack this. I wanted to see some of your faces and stuff, and love you guys. Really looking forward to when the world starts back up again so we can all see each other again. Hey Terry, let me know if you're gonna make that shirt, man. I'll absolutely grab one of those, man. And looking forward to all your new stuff. It seems like you're just pumping out new stuff after new stuff, and I'm loving it all, man.
Thank you. Absolutely.
If you ever get a wild hair up your ass and want to draw Thor, hit me up.
Actually, I did a story for Elseworlds or something, and I wrote a story about how Thor got his strap from M. Jolnir. There was a time when M. Jolnir didn't have a strap, and he kept flying out of his hand.
Really?
Yes.
When was this?
Oh, I don't know.
Was it one of those
somewhere in the bookshelf? It's for one of those cartoony versions, you know, where just kind of go off on a tangent.
Yeah. Was it the Weird Tales?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. One so that was about like, what was that, like 2000, I want to say 2009 or 10?
So, I don't know.
I think that was 2009 because I had a story in that.
Right.
Strange Tales?
Yeah. That's one. And Raphael Grandpa had one and Nick Patara did one. Was it in that same era?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
I have it right here. I can grab it. I got that.
The archivist. Hey, you guys are talking about guitars. I can show you my turntables.
I mean, Sanford, if you break out your turntables, I don't want to just see them hoes, dude.
When people get turntables, do they get new ones or do they get the classic TX or something? Or
oh no, this is not for collecting. This is more just for turntable, you know, mixing. So it's not necessarily, you know, getting classic hardware. Not like for, you know, it's not like what you guys do with guitars. I get it just to play the music and mix. So
did you used to like DJ in clubs or whatever the fuck?
Not really.
Yeah. But
not well, it's one of those things. Maybe one day we'll talk. I'll tell you when I used
Okay. Cause you're the same way as I am with drums. Cause like I've been playing drums for like 20 years and people are like, you in bands and shit? I'm like, no. I just like getting angry at editorial and smashing things.
One of my winter projects, because it's pretty clear that, you know, COVID's not going away anytime soon. Sure. I am writing a concept album based on my favorite science fiction book series, Hyperion. Yeah. I'm trying to do it.
Are you doing it in the same style that you did like your Star Wars like mini comics and stuff that you did?
Oh, it's not a mini comic. It's like an actual musical album. Like I'm writing.
Oh, that's fucking cool, man.
That is cool.
What's the Hyperion? That sounds familiar.
It's like it's kind of like sci-fi Canterbury Tales. Oh. At least the first volume is. It's excellent. It's one of my favorites of all time.
Cool.
I haven't read that, but I'm always.
Oh wait, Terry, I grabbed Strange Tales, but you're not in this one. You must be in the second volume.
I'll see if I can find it.
This one has...
Well, Terry's looking for that.
John Hickman, though. That very not well-known creator, John Hickman, appears in this one.
So. I never heard of
him. Is in here, too.
No, Tom, it's Kirkman. It's pronounced Kirkman.
Let's see some of that Dan Brereton real quick. Dan, how's your coaster looking?
I got two done. Crypt of Terror, the Crypt Keeper is done.
Tales.
And
awesome, dude. EC Classic.
Black Cat is done. Yeah. Went a little crazy. And turned it. Oh my God,
that's it looks great, man.
I don't know. I should have drawn them all like in a diamond shape. I don't know.
I'm feeling that.
That's really smart. Yeah. Yeah, that's great.
I'm feeling that diamond shape too. That's pretty sweet.
That's like the greatest compliment you can get when another artist wants to steal your art. That's good.
So I gotta tell you, there's a load of writers that should feel super complimented by me. I just say shit all the time.
Past is prologue, man. The past is prologue.
That's right.
Wait, is everyone on their third one already?
I'm on number two. No,
I'm wrapping number three right now. I'm about to start four.
So I just started four.
You guys all have the same set of prompts, like per. Oh no!
Everyone has a different one. They're all custom.
Yeah. Oh, that's really cool.
But I did find my Dan Brereton story that I love so much, Black Terror.
Oh yeah!
It's only going back to 1989. No, 1990.
That character right there influenced me a lot.
Yeah.
It's the most beautiful painting stuff in here I've ever seen.
Thanks, Terry. I started that when I was still in art school.
Really? Can you hold up again?
I was in my last semester at the Academy in San Francisco, and we had an assignment that was, I had an illustration class with Kazuhiko Sano, who was a movie poster and paperback. He was a great illustrator. He did the Return of the Jedi movie posters, just one of his credits. And anyway, so he said, do whatever you want as a semester project, working on it on the weekends. And then, around just before Christmas time, we would show what we were doing. So I started doing a painted comic book story based on this Black Terror, a revamp of the Golden Age Black Terror. And the idea was that maybe Eclipse would hire me. And they did. And they hired me.
Well, that is such a gorgeous looking book, Terry.
It's a three-parter.
Oh, wow. It's never been collected.
Beautiful. Whole life, I've had two of three. I've never been able to find the third book.
Really? Yeah, it's a tough one. The third one.
Who's coloring that?
Todd McFarlane owns the rights to the Black Terror, and we've been trying for years to put it back into a trade paperback, and it's been very difficult to get his attention.
Well, isn't that character, Dan? That character is public domain, right?
But he owns the this particular incarnation because he bought. He bought the entire Eclipse library. And then the actual films for the book, were bought by some guy from a warehouse sale, and he's not helping out. So if we do it, we have to scan the comic book. It's really sad.
That's bizarre. Yeah. Have you talked to Larson about that? I know he has a ton of experience in that kind of
not recently. I know Eric and stuff, but Eric was very helpful in getting me going with my first Image stuff back when I was still doing stuff with Image. But basically, if the films aren't there, you basically have to scan the technology is a lot better than it was for doing things like that. I've had to do it in the past with some of my other stuff where.
The reason I ask is because Eric just just a week ago did a really long thread on Twitter about that exact process and about how it's advanced and stuff.
Yeah, that's interesting to know. But since one of the co-writers of the Black Terror is Bo Smith, he's an Image guy, so he definitely would have a connection with Eric too to talk about that. And but I think it's not IDW, but Ted Adams and his partner who founded IDW and now have kind of more of a boutique publishing outfit that's much more smaller. They're the ones that want to do it. So we'll see. We have to get Todd to sign off on it. And who knows?
It looks gorgeous. Is that fully painted?
Yeah, that's how I kind of started. Comics. My first job was a penciling job that no one really cared about. The editor said that what did Kat and Dean think? Kat Ironwood and Dean Mullaney were the husband and wife team who were the publisher and the editor for the Eclipse Comics. And when I did my first penciling job, which was a backup story, it was actually written by a young Kurt Busiek and drawn by a young Dan Brereton, who was in his early 20s. I said, what did you guys think? And they said, well, they were mildly unimpressed.
What?
And that was my penciling job, my first penciling job, which is fair. And I was in San Diego and they told me that. And I went home a day early because I was so depressed. It was also the same weekend that I saw Dave McKean, Kent Williams, George Pratt, and Jay Muth were all in Artist Alley. This is back when Comic-Con was just like, basically two big rooms.
Right, yeah.
They were all working on their painted books and they had artwork from their painted books. And I think Dave McKean was working on Black Orchid.
Oh, sure, yeah.
And I just saw what they were doing and I was like, that's what I want to do. And I just got real dejected. And the next day I took a flight home. I came home early. I was so depressed. But then that following semester back at art school is when I started doing my own painted pages. And then they hired me by January. I was working on the book, and I was still in my last semester of art school. And then I got a job doing a book called The Psycho with DC Comics, which was a creator owned book that I did with Jim Hudnall.
That's and a personal favorite of Mr. Tim Seeley. The personal favorite. Love that book.
Yeah, I'm glad you like it. That was another sort of, that was when I was still kind of an art student. I still thought like an art student, and I still experimented and had a lot of nervous energy like an art student. And, you know, Jim was like, oh, it's going to be bigger than Watchmen. And I said, shut up, you know. But we had full carte blanche to do whatever we wanted. So we just created all these crazy characters, and I had a ton of fun with that book.
Where did you go to art school?
I first went to California College of Arts and Crafts in Oakland, which is now called the California College of Arts. They dropped the
crafts. Arts and Crafts sounds a little like, you know, sounds like a flea market in a VFW hall somewhere.
I think they called it, and to be fair, there were no male students for about 70 years at that school. And when, well, maybe not 70 years, but for 70 years, they didn't let any guys live in the dorms with the girls. And that the first year I went was the first year that they opened it up to males. And there were 4 guys and 68 girls. That was my freshman year. I think because there was a lot of crafts, and back when they started the school, the word craft was more like the craft of textiles, the craft of bronze sculpture,
sure, right,
craft paper making, you know, printmaking. So yeah. Craft being like, you know, it had a connotation, but they did drop that eventually long after I was there. But they didn't have much of an illustration department, and the head of the school of design was in charge of the illustration department. He was trying to shut it down, and he used to tell the design students, well, the illustrators are going to be the people you hire, you know, who cares about them? So some of us, about 3 of us, went across the bridge to San Francisco, across the bay, and we went and checked out the Academy of Art College in San Francisco. And we were blown away by not only the fact that they had an illustration department that was 2 or 3 times the size of ours. There were things like they had, they didn't just have a clothed figure drawing class that we didn't even have. They had 4 clothed figure drawing classes. And also it was cheaper to go there. So 3 of us jumped ship. And then the next semester, about 4 or 5 other people jumped ship. And there are a lot of comic book people came out of there. They weren't really big on comics when I was going there, but now they have a comic book department. And, you know, so I left that school doing comics and never looked back. And it basically was painted stuff that was kind of propelled me doing the painted stuff. And I still do it, even though there really isn't the same market for it that there was. It's become kind of a niche thing. I'm like the guy that still makes furniture out of wicker. You know,
I went to art school at the Savannah College of Art and Design. I wanted to be a penciler, and I got there and I was in classes with Trad Moore, Sean Murphy, Jeff Shaw.
Wow.
And so I quickly was just like, maybe I'll try to be a writer. And I used my the scholarship money that I had got, actually from being a sculptor. I used all the scholarship money I had to start just hiring those guys to make ash cans for me and stuff.
Oh, that's awesome. That's good. You have to, this is the one thing I kind of was lucky, because I lucked into the whole idea of they will pay to do this, and then you can pitch them an idea and then they'll pay you to do that idea. And I thought, well, when I was doing that, I thought, wow, I'm set. You know, anything right. I can come with, they'll buy it, and I can do whatever I want. And then that changed. Now, after the creator-owned thing has never really gone away necessarily, but there was a point in time when you had a Legend and Bravura, which was I was part of, and you know, obviously Image, which came first. After that stuff kind of calmed down, the creator-owned stuff calmed down, and then comics in general in the mid-90s calmed down quite a bit, unfortunately. By about 2000-2001, painted comics were not I think there was a regime change at DC Comics that kind of did me in, to be honest.
They weren't too crazy about Elseworlds. They weren't crazy about painted books.
That's
insane. If you were Alex Ross, you were safe, you know. But the idea
was some of the greatest stuff they ever did. I mean, that all of that Elseworlds stuff is phenomenal.
Yeah, I agree. I think, and I'm not just saying that because I did one.
No, you're absolutely right. I mean,
but it was the freedom to be creative with these characters and play in the sandbox and kind of show different facets, but still stay true to the character is right. Kind of genius. And the fact that they stopped doing them is mind-boggling to me.
I can't tell you how many Marvel creative retreats where we've discussed, like, man, we have this brand just sitting right here, this what if brand.
Yeah.
Like, instead of doing just one shots, like, why don't we build them into?
Yeah, exactly. You could do the same thing. And that's actually a great idea. I remember when go ahead.
According to the economics guys, the sales guys, you know, they're so scared of doing books that quote unquote don't count, you know. And certainly, like, those Elseworlds books had such a great quality because they had such, like, top-tier artists and writers and stuff, that they somehow figured out this, like, alchemy of making them feel like they still counted in a bizarre way. And I think it's what you were talking about, is they still felt true to the character. Like, it still very much felt like a real piece of that overall puzzle, you know?
It's like any superhero or any character that you're tackling, you have the story should be unique to that character. And it's the same thing with Elseworlds. In fact, if it isn't, it doesn't work at all.
Right.
Even though we kind of did some change around with the one I did with Howard Chaykin for Thrill Killer, dynamic duo were Robin and Batgirl. And Bruce Wayne was a cop who becomes Batman eventually. It was still true to who these people were, and you know, and there were just some great stories. And I don't think you should hamstring anybody from doing great comics. I love working on comics that don't matter.
Well, that's a thing too. Honestly,
I know that's what you're talking about too. And you know what? I think that is. When I think back to when I got into comics in the mid-70s when I was like 8 or 9 years old, and like seeing Deathlok, the Demolisher, on the stands was one of the most exciting things in comics that happened to me. And I don't think that was necessarily something that was supposed to be some giant event. But right. Back then, they gave everything some equal importance. You know, they said, this is a brand new thing. We're excited about it. Yeah. And they put it out. They didn't try and make everything into an event, you know.
You know what I think it honestly is? I think it's a matter of branding, where Elseworlds, that title, implied that these things are canon in an alternate world, and that world keeps going. And What If is so the antithesis of that. That's you know, these things, like the title itself implies this didn't happen and will never happen. But Elseworlds always had that feeling of, this could cross over, like this, you know, Gotham by Gaslight could be a thing. Like they did a really great job in their branding, same way as Vertigo, of establishing that, like, no, this matters, this counts, it's just adjacent.
Right, right. We did more than one.
It should just be, the approach should be, none of this matters. It's a superhero book.
It right, there's
matter.
That.
Yeah. None of it matters.
That's Tim and I's new imprint.
Yeah, none of this matters.
None of this shit fucking matters.
And yet,
all the covers are just black.
Alan Moore line from when he did, you know, Whatever Happened to the Man of Tomorrow.
Right.
Then this is an imaginary story, but then again, aren't they all?
Yeah, there you go.
Right. Yeah, I mean, you think about all these titles that have become evergreens that on their face are non-canonical stories that have become evergreens. I mean, when Dark Knight Returns
is the perfect example.
Yeah. When Dark Knight Returns first began life, it was non-canonical, as was Year One, and then Kingdom Come, right? But over the time, because of their popularity, they've all been folded in. Like Kingdom Come was folded into, what was it, Justice Society? The Geoff Johns Justice Society one, right?
Yeah.
Well, that's what Dan said at the time.
DC made a fairly, at least an 80% overture to it when they did what I kind of called the new 49. After they had the new 52, and then they had what they called DCU, but then they were revamping everything to 49 titles.
Right.
They basically had as their mandate, we're going to make our versions of these characters sort of the best version of these characters. Yeah, so we're going to pull from this and pull from that. We'll pull some Batman stuff from Dark Knight Returns, and we'll pull, you know, this from Kingdom Come. We're going to make the best version of this. Yeah. But the problem was, at the same time, they had enough stuff that was entertaining. I mean, they had a new Prez title. That's when they had We Are Robin, you know, which was like the Robin. Like they had stuff that was cool and interesting, yeah, but it wasn't commercial in the first 6 months. And, right, and then
Grayson, I was right in that shit.
Grayson, there you go, man. I mean, you know, when it wasn't commercial in the first 6 months, yeah, they said, well, the whole idea must stink. It's, yep, like, no, it just needed a little bit more than 6 months to germinate. And it's unfortunate. You do wind up with that very short-term, yep, quarterly report to the stockholders,
right,
kind of thinking. And when that takes over a creative enterprise, hey, you guys know better than me. It can be difficult.
Hey, yeah. Tim, speaking of you and this kind of stuff, you tweeted out, I think maybe in response to a thread that I was on, that it's well, first let me say this, how fucking cool it is that AFWA got such acclaim for the Lovecraft Country art that she did. Oh, and yeah, everything. Sure. And Tim, you were talking about it, I mean, we're talking about the great projects that never were, man. I one of these days, you've got to, next time we hang out, you gotta tell me your Blade pitch. I that was so over the, I'm such a huge Blade nut job, and I was, when that book got announced, man, I was all, I think I emailed you a few times and was just like, man, this looks fucking amazing and everything. I know probably this isn't the greatest forum in the world for you to tell that whole story, but one of these days I'd love to hear what you guys were going to be planning.
Oh man. Yeah. That's one of those that got away on you. And now that it's, you know, like it would just be so hard to get back into it, but
right,
it was fun. Then it was just that's a weird time politically, you know, like it was just
How much did you guys get complete? Like, how far down the road in that did you get before?
Three scripts and two issues drawn, I think.
Wow. Still exist?
Yeah. I think the first issue was mostly, maybe, I mean, it was just, I don't know. There were so many versions of it because they kept firing the artists and it was a whole thing. I don't think they would have that problem now. I think it was just sort of that time, but
One of these days, you should do like how Kirkman did with his Destroyer book and just publish it at home and pass out at
show. I have a feeling, I do think it's one of those things at some point they're going to bring it back, you know, in some version, just because they're going to have a Blade movie, you know.
Well, you know, they reached out to me about that, but it was like so far down the line that I had no idea.
Yeah, I put you on the list of people to call.
Yeah.
Oh, wait, for the old book? For the Blade's daughter thing?
Yeah. So Sanford was on there. Yeah, we talked. I mean, I remember you and I talked about it. It was just, I was partly the timing because it was the Black Panther book was supposed to come out and it got delayed. And then.
Yeah.
It was all messy. It's just.
All the art that got out at least looked fucking so cool, man. Wait, am I able to curse on this? I've been cursed for some asked. Time.
Okay. Too late.
I'm so sorry.
That was my first question.
Well, hey,
no worries.
I this is not my
don't
fucking
blasphemies. I'm Catholic and I'm very, very sensitive.
Jim is the most sensitive person I know.
Get back to it. Really nice seeing all you guys. Draw, have fun. It's nice talking with you guys.
Huh? Good to talk to you.
Good seeing you, man.
Thanks so much. Donnie, thanks so much. And we're going to see Donny Cates tomorrow with Ryan Stegman with some King in Black panel.
If he fucking shows up this time,
All right. So I finished mine.
Let's see it.
All of them?
So we got a Hulk.
Shit, I'm almost there. Okay, what do you got?
We got Dr. Voodoo.
Oh, wow.
Oh, man.
Nice.
So
I did my best with this Luke in the cockpit
thing.
That's great, man.
You did your best.
Here's the somebody asked for my character from Extremity,
So
that's great, man. Nice.
Well, I just finished a Jane Foster Thor.
Oh, good stuff.
Beautiful. Wow.
Now I'm working on Batman. You know, I don't know if you guys have heard of that character before.
Of who?
Oh, man. So talking
very
about
obscure. Like, I mean, that's like Seeley level if you're getting into Batman. I mean, who's ever heard of that?
All right. I like that story where Donnie said he got a Batman from Tom. That was pretty awesome.
Yeah.
So talking about like
very nice. You know,
kind of like where we come from and like inspiration and stuff. I remember Emerald City 2015. Mm-hmm. I was working on a book that I was like really burnt out on called Alabaster. And as I was wrapping it up, I was like, man, I really got to figure out how to have fun drawing comics again. And that was right around the time that I was reading a bunch of Becky's little ash can mini comics.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. And you were just like printing them off and just selling them. No big deal.
I still do that.
Yeah. And they weren't related to anything. And I was like, man, I should just do this.
Just do that.
And that was a big reason why I did like my mini comics, like Green Leader and like Martok, things like that.
Oh, no way.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. All right, I'm done with mine. Let's see. We got Megan Fox, Jennifer Body, and we got Mystique.
Ooh.
And Zartan from G.I. Joe's.
Ooh.
Nice.
Michael Myers.
Nice.
And hard to draw. And then a Thor.
Nice.
That's awesome.
Sweet.
Nice Power Trip shirt, Becky.
What's up?
Nice Power Trip shirt.
Oh, yeah. I've been wearing this for, like, 2 weeks. I'm, like, going to wear it until it just falls off, I think.
It's our pandemic wardrobe. It's like I change shirts once every 3-4 days, maybe. Maybe.
Tony, how's your art going? Have you got to your Howard the Duck yet?
That's the last one. I've got everything else done. I've got Deckard from Do Andre's Dream of Electric Sheep right here. Nice. I still need to add a red to Morbius, the Living Vampire. And I'm almost done with the original version of James O'Barr, The Crow.
Ooh, nice.
The Crow is so freaking awesome.
That's great.
I'm just going to have fun listening to y'all talk.
How about you, Megan?
Tony, you're great at everything, but that crow is insane, man.
Yeah, that's so good.
Thank you so much.
Megan, I have not had dinner yet, and it's 9:30, so I have to go. My wife is about to eat me.
It's your baby.
Yep.
Oh, my baby has been asleep for a long time, and she will be until 8 o'clock tomorrow.
Yeah.
How old's the baby?
2¾.
Wow! Congratulations.
Proud dad story. My wife has taught her how to just crack eggs into the bowl. She helps her cook.
Wow.
And no, she never gets the shell in the bowl. It's amazing.
Wow, that kicks ass.
It's really awesome, cool. Man.
That was my 11-year-old who's going out for ice cream, and he's not taking me. So there's your future.
Yeah, I guess. Right on.
On the other hand, we'll give the sponsor a quick plug. I just got a package with the whiskey here from Wiggle Distillery. And artists, you've got this coming. I apologize if you haven't got it yet. We're one of the sponsors, so I might have got mine earlier, but oh, there we go.
Sean's got his.
Awesome. All right.
I've got one right here.
Excellent. Hey, everybody got theirs. All right, so I'm not as special as I think.
I got my gym.
Oh, you're special.
is Terry still here?
Yeah.
Okay, just wanted to say I'm a big fan, big inspiration, just like Donnie said.
Thank you, Daniel.
Same, yep. I'll say the same.
Yeah, same here.
And I'm too shy to say anything.
And thank you, universal. Thank you to everybody watching. Thank you to everybody watching and supporting us as creators. I really appreciate it. I know we all appreciate it. I'm sorry that I have to duck out early, but you know, take care, everybody, and I'll talk
to you.
Thank
you, man. Thank you,
Daniel Warren Johnson. People, one of the best.
Bye, bye, guys.
Love your stuff, man.
That's awesome, Sean. How are you doing? It looks like you got the Miles Morales looking good up there.
Yeah, so I got three of them, or four. This is my fourth one finishing up. Nice. I got a Psylocke, which hopefully is showing up on screen there. Jeff the Land Shark.
Cool.
And Wolverine I showed earlier, so I got to finish up the Spider-Man, and then somebody actually asked for my creator-owned character, Scarlet Huntress, so I'm saving that for last.
Hell yeah, that's nice.
Yeah.
Anytime they fans ask for the creator-owned stuff, that's always got to feel good to you, you know?
Oh, yeah,
it
yeah.
does.
Mm-hmm. Megan, how are you doing on yours? Line up?
They're all ready to go.
was Donnie interrupting your masterpieces?
I'm slacking. I'm still working on my third one. I finished my Batgirl. I'm not doing color on mine, and everyone's doing color, and I feel like
I'm not doing color.
I'm not doing color.
You put gold on yours, Becky. Don't lie to me. No,
it's not a competition.
It's always a competition.
Except with artists, it's always a competition.
Exactly.
By the way, funny story. Many of you guys know this. When Hero Initiative does the 100 project books, I always get artists who call me in a blind panic and they go, hey man, I just sent in my cover. You know, I'm really happy with it. I'm really proud of it. You know, I hope you really like it. I hope people dig it. Just do me a favor. Whatever you do, you can't put me on the page opposite Bill Sienkiewicz. Whatever you do, it's like, I can't be across from Sienkiewicz. And I'm always like, dude, we just line them up alphabetically. So, you know,
yeah.
Andy Smith, you're probably screwed. But the rest of you, you're safe. You're always safe.
I'm okay.
No, unless you're across from George Perez, like I am half the time.
Hey, Jim, where can we find that husky of yours on Twitter?
Actually, she does have a Twitter account. It's Snowy. I think it's Snowy T Husky. Snowy the Siberian Husky.
That's awesome.
One of the best, man. Yeah. One of the best right there.
I follow your husky on Twitter.
You should.
I do. Awesome.
By the way, funny story. It was my wife's birthday a couple of months ago, so I asked our son, he's 11 years old, I said, hey, what should we get mom for her birthday? Let's do something fun, something interesting, something cool. And he said, well, hey, I've got a great idea. Why don't, she wants to get more followers, you know, for Snowy, the Husky's Twitter account. Why don't we create like 1,000 fake accounts and follow her? And I'm like, you know, that sounds like a lot of work and probably unethical and makes us kind of like Russian disinformation bots. Let's just ask some friends. So I sent an email out to a bunch of people, probably you included, Megan, yes, who started following Snowy, and it's 100% good dog content all the time. Snowy the Siberian Husky. Look it up.
Wait a minute. Killdozer is 11 years old now?
Killdozer is 11 years old. Dan, you tell the story.
When Jim and his wife were expecting, he sent an email to a bunch of different people, and he said, hey, you know, we're having a baby. You know, we'd love to hear some suggested, you know, names. And mine was Killdozer. And James liked it.
Actually, it was Spuds Killdozer McLaughlin. Killdozer was going to be the middle name. And you know, I got a lot of smart-ass friends. I got a lot of smart-ass responses, but Spuds Killdozer McLaughlin was without a doubt.
I put a lot of thought.
Dan was besting show on that one.
How did you not go with that?
I put a lot of thought into it.
I would have loved it. My wife did not let me.
Well, you know, Killdozer, when it's with Spuds, it's a harder sell, you know, than if it's with something like, you know, Christopher.
You are his unofficial godfather.
Maybe someday I'll even get to meet him. That would be amazing. Say, you were so close to being Spud's Killdozer, it's not even funny.
Sean, which one are you working on right now?
Now I'm doing my creator-owned character.
That's right. You told me that. How about you, Tom? Which ones? Can you show us some of the ones you've done?
Let's see. I got Medusa done.
Nice.
That way. Yeah. Deadpool.
Oh, wow. That's great.
I love the half mask.
It's a little more interesting than just, mm-hmm. just the mask. And Duffman.
Nice.
That was a surprise.
That half mask Deadpool reminds me of Rorschach eating them beans.
Yes.
Yeah.
Awesome. Sanford, how's yours going?
Yeah, pretty good. Here's Misty Knight. See that?
There she is. Oh, nice. Hell yeah.
Got was that Brother Voodoo?
Mm-hmm. That's nice. Awesome.
And what do I have here? Work in progress. Three work in progress. So I should be done in about 20 minutes. Miles and Boom Boom from the X-Men.
Oh, yeah. That's awesome. Boom. Yeah. How's yours doing over there, Terry?
I got mine done. I had to do Aunt Libby from Motor Girl with the shooting at the UFOs. Don't shoot at the UFOs. You'll just piss them off.
Yep.
little Zoe. I like this one. Zoe, she's a 10-year-old serial killer because I was tired of the serial killer always being the big guy. I wanted the town to have, you know, the worst, the most dangerous person was 10 years old. And then this is Ever from the new series.
That's awesome. You know, Terry, you were saying you went to a school in Richardson. My dad taught about 20-something odd years at old Westwood Junior High on Arapahoe Road back in the day.
Yeah. Wow.
I'm just up in McKinney, so I'm not too far.
Bro, you talking about Arapahoe Road, man?
Arapahoe Road, Donnie. My dad taught at Westwood Junior High. You been there?
Really?
Hell yeah.
That's fucking crazy,
your
man.
Your Texan is coming out.
Oh, I know. I start getting about Arapahoe. You know how
hell
I
yeah, boy. Hell yeah.
You grew up out there or what?
I'm McKinney, Texas.
McKinney?
Yep.
You ever go to what was your comic book shop out there?
Well, we had one called Ken and Tanya's, a mom and pop store, but they shut it down. But I went to the Lone Star Comics in Plano.
Yeah, the Lone Star Comics in Plano. Yeah.
That was a good shop, man.
They had that one by Townies Mall that was just right there. That was my spot.
Damn, hell yeah. Getting some of that Buddy Saunders action.
Yeah, man. Actually, absolutely, man. All right. Now I'm really gone, I promise.
Oh, man.
I remember Buddy Saunders.
You do? Yeah, man. Terry and Megan, y'all some Texas folks. That's what it's all about.
I'm from LA.
But how are you enjoying Austin, though? Austin's pretty freaking awesome.
I love it. I've been here for over a year, and it's much better than LA. LA is. Does anyone here live in LA?
Nope.
Or
nope. LA is a shithole. I lived there for 20 years. I used to work in the film industry. I had to live there, and that place sucks. So
every time I fly into LA, you approach this brown cloud, and you fly down through the cloud, and there's the town. Mm-hmm. It's awful.
It's not great. It really isn't. My parents still live in Orange County, so I have to go back.
There's a lot of LA people in Austin.
I know, and so don't tell them that I'm from LA. They don't like it, because a lot of people from LA are moving here because LA sucks. But I'm married a Texan, so I'm allowed to be here.
There used to be that problem with Colorado. Texans were moving to Colorado, and Colorado was mad about it.
Mm-hmm.
Because we brought our black pickups or something. I don't know.
Yeah, and you make all the housing prices go up.
You took the snow away.
You made it
stop snowing.
Megan, why does LA suck?
Have you been there?
Besides the obvious.
Real expensive, that's for sure.
It's really expensive. It's really dirty. Everyone's an asshole. It's not like New York where everyone's an asshole in a very charming way. Apparently everyone's just an asshole. Like, everyone's really nice in Texas, which is weird to me because stranger danger. For the amount of money that you spend to live out there, it's not worth it. You know, like, the quality of life isn't worth it. It's such a struggle. Now, like, when I was working in the film industry, you have to live out there, and it was fine because I was working all the time. You know, so I didn't notice how hard it was to live out there. But as soon as I moved out here, I was just like, why does anyone live there?
Right.
It's just so beautiful out here, you know?
And Terry, for you, you know, being a native Texan, this is like all you've known. Like, a lot of the people you meet, you know, here in Texas, real down to earth, real homey, you know, opening arms. But Terry, when you go to other places, you can probably tell the difference that the places you visit, they ain't Texas.
That's true. But I like almost everywhere I've been, but there's a couple of places that I don't belong. that I shouldn't go back to, like Alabama, maybe.
Fair enough.
Hope we don't have any Alabama folks in the chat.
I didn't do a check first, but no, I don't know. I like the diversity. Thing before I started traveling in comics, I thought it was one big country because that's what we were all taught in school. But then when you start traveling, going to these different cities and there's these different cultures and accents and food and all that stuff, it felt more and more like Europe. It's more, every state is like another little country in Europe, and we're like another Europe. We're Western Europe. Because if you go to Seattle and spend 4 days, and then you go to Chicago, spend 4 days, and then you go to Atlanta, I mean, my God, it's so different, you know.
Do you ever get people ask you, are you from Texas? You ever get that?
Yes. Once in a while, somebody will say they hear my accent, or more so in my wife. Mm-hmm. She has more of a draw.
Yeah. That's always fun, though, I feel, because it's a lot of times they were probably folks that used to live in Texas, you know?
Yeah, they recognize it. It's, and it's funny, there's different accents around our state, and just like there's a different French accent depending on whether you're in North France or South France. Mm-hmm. There's like 9 or 13 accents in the New York burgs alone. You know, there's 2 different Boston. I mean, it's crazy. I don't know how. What I am amazed at is why we still have such diverse accents, because mm-hmm. especially those who travel around, I spend as much time listening to somebody from another state as I do listen to anybody here. And how do you come up with a country singer that sounds like he's never been off a farm and in this day and age?
Exactly.
I an article about that, though. They are disappearing. American regional accents are going away.
Yeah,
there used to be like 4 different ones in Chicago, and now there's only 2. So they, like, at least locally, they're getting absorbed as people acclimate. You know, I mean, it's a good thing because people were in sort of clusters, right? The Irish side of Chicago, the Italian side of Chicago, the Polish side of Chicago, they all had different accents. But now
the Polish side of Chicago is all sides.
True. Well, that's actually kind of, you know, that's part of the thing, is people sort of, you know, they intermarry and move next to each other, and they move across town, and all those little regional accents start just getting absorbed, you know?
You know, it is interesting, though, and Seeley might be able to speak to this a little bit. One thing that was kind of lost on me, I'm from the Midwest. I'm from St. Paul, Minnesota, and Seeley's from Wisconsin, and I'm Irish, and, you know, honestly, the people in my cohort when I was kids, you know, very Irish Catholic, you know, sometimes first generation, you know, even in the 1970s, first generation from freaking Ireland, I could fall into a brogue very easily when I was talking to them. But by the same token, there's enough Germans in Minnesota that there's so many speech idioms that are Germanic that really permeated my language that I didn't even realize until years later. Like, we would just use the term fest for everything. Any good time, any party was a fest, you know, which is a German word for party. And you would say something like, oh yeah, we're all going to go to Tim's this weekend, you know, to watch the Vikings game. He's going to have a big beer fest. It'll be great. And I never realized until I moved out of Minnesota, I moved to New York, and I would say something like, oh yeah, we're going to have a great big football fest, you know, at my place this weekend. People are like, what's that? It's like, you know, big party, you know, we'll bring some beers, you know, we'll have some chips, we'll have some burgers. It's a big football fest. And they're like, what's a fest?
What? Who's saying what's a fest? That sounds ridiculous that they don't know what a fest is. I'm from Northern California. I know what a fest is.
There you go. But in New York, it's different. But, you know, Terry, you were talking about it. You know, the one thing that blew my mind, I lived in New York for 6 years, and people would honestly tell me that there was a North Long Island accent and a South Long Island accent. And I'm like, that entire island is 6 miles wide. I mean, how can there be north to south is 6 miles? But they would swear up and down. It's like there's a North Shore accent and a South Shore accent on Long Island.
Yeah. And I always loved it as a taking in information as a writer, how you could catch somebody in a lie or something like that, because, you know, they would say it the wrong way, or like make make the number three the wrong way with your hand, whether you're American or European. There's all those little things that you could put into your stories, you know, to tip somebody off. I never hear anything about, like, for instance, you guys were talking mainstream characters. You never hear anything about the Gotham accent. What is the Gotham accent, you know?
Hey, that's a good question.
Is it theoretically Chicago, but which Chicago accent is it going to be, you know? I think there should be a Gotham accent. And there's a North Gotham and a South Gotham. Yeah. And maybe they don't even like each other.
I want to see you write a Batman story just to explore these ideas, because that sounds really interesting.
I'm full of bad ideas. I could fuck that brand up so fast.
That's the only reason that Wolverine is Canadian, right? Because Lan and Chris used to dare each other to write accents. And the dare was, can you write a Canadian accent? And Lan was like, yeah, no problem. And so that's how they came up with Wolverine being Canadian, because he was supposed to say yeah and dare and all that sort of shit. Like, he's supposed to be like, yeah, but like, because, and if you read X-Men when Chris was doing it, you know, the most ridiculous stereotype versions of the Brogue and all that sort of stuff. But they were like, this was the greatest thing on earth for these nerds, you know? They were like writing all these accents. So it totally is a thing. But then now if you do it, it just doesn't, you know, if I do it now, everybody calls it's not authentic enough or whatever. So I just don't even bother, you know?
Every time I try to write an accent, like I was trying to write an old man in New York talking like what I hear, and Robin told me to stop. She said, don't do that. I didn't get away with it. So, you know, you used to do that, you know, you would write it like what you would hear. And she said, no, this should be this way. And I said, well, yeah, if you're an English teacher, but this is what he says. Mm-hmm. This is how he says it. You mixing up his C's and scenes and saws. And, but no, I in this day and age,
kind of like how Seeger wrote Popeye the Sailor Man or whatnot, you know?
Yeah. You know what? That came out, it hit its popularity in the first depression, the first depression. And he ate at a breakfast at the same cafe every morning.
Yep.
And he had to sit at the counter and everybody was having a tough time. And he became a millionaire during the Great Depression. Wow. Because people were, buying the newspapers and needed the escapism and the hope and the entertainment that he, mm-hmm. you know, people like him were offering. The movies shot up and all that, you know.
Yeah, I that's one of my favorite characters. They need to bring them back. IDW needs to bring some more of those back, you know.
All right, I gotta take off. I just want to make sure Jim, I packed them up. These are ready to go. Everybody's getting their art, so I'll come to you in a few days. Thank you so much for having me. This is a lot of fun. It was nice to see you all. Good to chat.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Thank you. I hope
this is good nice. Seeing you. It's not, you know, 100% face-to-face real, but
this is pretty,
you know,
close.
We get to be a couple of dozen people hanging out together, having a good time.
That's okay.
The nicest I've had in a while, so I appreciate that. That was the best Zoom I've had in far too long. So thank
Hell
you.
Hell yeah. Thanks so much, Tim.
All right, guys. Have a good night.
It's okay. I've got a bug out as well. I've got all five done here.
Awesome, Dan. Let's see him real quick, Dan.
Tony.
I'm leaving as well. Better Ray Bill.
There's Tony. Hell yeah.
There we go. Traditional classic Crow.
Mm-hmm.
Deckard from Do I Understream Electric Sheep.
Hopefully. Wow.
I added some color, just had peer pressure for Morbius Living Vampire.
It sure works, though.
It works. And finally, Howard the Duck.
That's awesome.
First time I've ever drawn him. So much fun.
And we do need a drink.
Yeah.
Several.
And with that, I'll see y'all. Thank you. I love all your guys' work. I'm so such a fanboy here. It's kind of why I've been quiet. I'm going to go back and watch this later while I'm not actually drawing it. And y'all have a wonderful night.
You too.
Take care,
Tony.
Yeah. Hey, Tony said y'all. Wonder where he's from.
Hey.
All over.
Somewhere in Chicago. Okay, I'm out of here, guys. Bye. Thanks for letting me play. So, I got all mine finished, and I'll send them in to you, Jim.
Thank you, good sir.
Okay.
Enjoy the Wiggle Whiskey from PA.
Absolutely will.
Take care.
Is anybody left? Who's left?
I'm here.
I'm still out here.
Oh, there you are.
Okay. I've Raney. Got so many to do.
Still there.
Tom Raney, how are you doing, man?
I'm doing well enough.
You're looking very well bearded, and looks like you haven't had a haircut in a while. So you're well into pandemic caveman
mode. It's been a little while. How you doing, man?
I'm doing well. You know, I've got my 1974 hockey goon Fu Manchu mustache going on here. I had the beard for a while, but then I went down to hockey goon mustache. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking of getting rid of this too, though. We'll see.
When you said hockey goon, I just Slapshot came into my mind. Some of that old Oglethorpe and the Hanson brothers.
An all-time classic. An all-time classic.
Mm-hmm. Love that movie. Becky, how are you doing? Which one are you on right now?
I'm on Zatanna. I finished the Batman. See, look at I stole the diamond shape. Stole it.
That belongs to the world.
Straight up. Thievery going on here. And I'm on to Zatanna right now. She's cool. Not long. Yeah, I don't know. We'll see. We'll see how it happens.
See, Dan, you've taken the Dutch tilt, you've made it insane, and now it's propagating around the Zoom globe. You're a trendsetter, my friend.
Okay, so here's another thing I'm going to do since my cards are done. So I just finished Nightcrawler.
Wow.
Oh, my God.
I have an X-Men story coming out in November in Marvel Anthology number 2. So I did this character a lot last year. And I actually wrote the story, so I had to write all those bad accents and stuff too. not the accents, but you know what I'm talking about. But it was fun.
Yep.
I went back and I soaked up all the Chris Claremont and the Dave Cockrum I could for a 10-page story. So check that out when it comes out next month. Vampirella. I used to do her a lot, but I do her less these days because I've done her so much. Batgirl from Thrill Killer. Speaking of Elseworld, that's my Batgirl version. Crypt Keeper, you guys saw the Crypt Keeper.
Mm-hmm. I could look at that Crypt Keeper all day.
Black Cat, I like the way this one came out. And then a few days ago when these showed up, I kind of tried them out. So I did a Harley Quinn. This was a few days ago. I did a Harley Quinn. So I'll probably put that in there. And Jim, you can do what you want with it, you know.
HeroInitiative.org/merchandise.
Yeah, you know, maybe I'll just put my drink on it. You know, maybe I'll put
this
rye on it.
No.
Yeah, I'll personalize you. So since I'm not drinking this, I mean, I would love to, but I'm diabetic, so I can't have sweet cinnamon whiskey. Sorry. Mm. But what I did do is I put a little acrylic gesso on the back, and I'm going to draw a devil on the back. Nice. And then you can do what you want with that, too.
That is amazing, man.
So I'm going to ink that now.
Sweet.
Look at this, dude. You have taken drink and draw to its logical conclusion.
Just draw on everything.
Draw on the drink. There we go. That's amazing, man.
I see Sean's working up there looking good. Sean, how you doing on that one there?
Good. I was sitting here staring at all the other ones I did, and I didn't add color to this one. Well, at least not a lot of color. So I thought I'd go back in. Add a little touch of color to it, and I think I'm going to wrap this one up and call it an evening here.
It's awesome. Very cool. Some nice gestures. That's what folks are saying in the chat. Everyone has been superb tonight. A lot of great fans. Thank y'all so much, donors that are here with us in the Zoom call, and you've got to see your favorite artists do some of their best work just for you. And we really appreciate you for all you do for the Hero Initiative, helping the creators in need. And man, Jim, we have a good time doing this. You know, at heroinitiative.org/merchandise, you can check out these Q&A panels to where you can have the awesome experience of asking your favorite creators some of those questions you've always wanted to ask them in an intimate setting. It's just a blast. You know, me and Jim, we both are in there sometimes, and we get to listen to some of the stories that the creators will tell the audience, and it's just an amazing time. Also, Jim, like you said, the Hero Initiative 100 project. I'm a big Fantastic Four fan, and I recently got that from heroinitiative.org, and it's just the artwork in there is beautiful. To look and see everyone's different takes on some of my favorite characters is just awesome. And Jim, you know, you're one of the best. I thank you so much for what you do, because it means a lot to me. It means a lot to the Comic Corps, and it's good to have a group watch the comic creators' backs, you know, when times get tough or when times get rough.
Well, thank you for saying, man. It's very kind of you to say. You know, it's weird. I'll tell the brief and hopefully universal anecdote. You know, this is not even one specific case. This applies a lot. And when we started Hero Initiative, I would very often hear, and this sounds hokey, but I would hear grown-ass men cry. And I would hear people crying on the phone. And it really used to upset me. You know, it used to kind of freak me out. Like, oh my God, what's going on? You know, am I doing something wrong? Am I making people cry? But I really realized after a short period of time that what was happening was people were crying when we jumped up and said, hey man, we're going to help you. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to send you a check. We're going to pay the 3 months back rent so you actually don't get evicted tomorrow. You know, we're going to send over a $400 grocery card so you can go to the grocery store. You can actually get some food. And it was at that point that people would start crying. And I really realized that there are so many people, particularly some of the older creators, who just heard no for so long. The universe was giving them no. It's like, no, I don't have any work for you. No, you know, your style is dated. No, don't, people aren't interested in you. No, you can't have another week to pay the rent. You got to pay it now. And when we finally entered their lives, they finally heard yes for the first time. And at that point, after hearing so many no's, it's like this dam just broke. You know, there was all this emotion and it just went. And the body doesn't know how to react. And people would start crying. And again, for a while, it felt really weird and strange and oogie of me. And I felt like I was almost doing something bad. But very fortunately, in a short period of time, I realized, no, this is part of the process. And this is the good part of the process. And I can't actually say I like hearing people cry, but now I'm totally comfortable with it. And again, I heard it today. You know, there are situations all over the place. And today, you know, I finally said to somebody, hey man, yes, I'm going to send you some money via PayPal now so you can actually get some groceries. Mm-hmm. And he starts crying. And it took me a little while to get over that very small hump. But now those moments are not bad. They're not oogie for me. I know they're part of the process and I feel a heck of a lot better about them, but honestly, it's because of people like all of you. You know, it's the artists doing the work tonight. It's the fans who have bought in and having some fun. Legend, it's you giving your own not inconsiderable talents, you know, to an event like this and running it and bringing everybody into an environment that feels like home. It's because of all of this, man. We are all in this together. And I think hopefully if there's one lesson that the craziness of 2020 is going to teach us, it's that we're all threads in a way larger tapestry. We're all in everything together, and we got to be together, and it works better when we're together. And look, we've said it many times tonight. It's not 100% what we might want. We're not in Baltimore tonight. You know, we're in 20 different cities all across the country, but we're having a good time and we're doing it because we're all together. You know, it takes all of us.
That's it, Jim.
Thank you, Jim.
All said.
That was nowhere near as brief as I thought it was going to be.
I think as brief as it needed to be.
Ledge, can I jump in real quick?
Go. Yeah, man. This is our producer behind the scenes working on all this crazy digital software stuff. Chad, what do you got going on, brother? Chad from the Comic Corps.
Chad's the guy who arranged to get the booze sent to us, so that's very, very important.
I just wanted to jump in and say, hey, I haven't had my 5 minute of gym for the past 4 days, and I'm raising a glass, brother.
Slunch, brother.
Jim, man, God bless you, Jim.
Hey, to all of you,
Jim. I think you're trying to make grown man cry again, man. Is what you're trying to do.
Hell yeah.
Hey, Jim. You told me a story years ago about how I think it might have been when the organization you were running was called Actor.
and how you got kind of overwhelmed yourself and you weren't sure if you should continue. And a person that we both know named Harris Miller gave you some good advice. I love, can you tell that story? Cause I love that story.
Oh God.
We got it. You got to tell it now.
Thanks for putting me on the spot, pal. Really appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Yeah. So long story short, you know, Hero has been around for 20 years now. And, you know, after 20 years, things are ticking along. Things are going okay. We know what we're doing. We got both feet on the ground. Everything's all right. But in the earliest days, I mean, things were very touch and go. I mean, this was kind of me figuring out how to do this, working in real time. But at the same time, I had a full-time job. I had freelance work, and then I was running a charity at the same time. And what I had really done is I just created a separate email, you know, for any Hero Initiative stuff. And when I would get an email during the week, I would forward it to my other email, and then I would pick it up on the weekend. And I would spend all weekend after working all week, then working on all the Hero stuff. And I mean, I was burning the candle at both ends, and I was working like 80 hours a week, and it was driving me crazy. And we barely had our heads above water, and it was stressful to the nth degree. So at one point, I really thought, this is it. You know, it's like I can't do this anymore because it's driving me crazy, and it's going to affect my life and my health and everything else. I just have to kind of tank it. You know, I'll declare victory. We'll walk away. We'll fold the organization. We said, hey, we did whatever we did for whatever period of time. You know, we dispersed this money. We helped out these people. It's great. You know, now we're going away. Good night. So I had a conversation with a guy by the name of Harris Miller. Harris is a intellectual property lawyer. A lot of guys in the comics business use him for contracts and so on. And I figured I would give Harris a call because Harris is a nice guy. He's a smart guy and he's a lawyer. What do I need to do to dissolve a corporation? You know, lawyers, they dissolve corporations. They can help me out. They can tell me. So I told him everything. I just told you, man, it's driving me nuts. Man, it's working around the clock. Man, I don't think I can handle it anymore. Man, we're barely got our heads above water. I got to, you know, put this away. Hey, Harris, what do you think? And I lay this all out. And I hear like 10 seconds worth of silence on the other end of the phone. And I'm like, hello, Harris? Harris? Harris, are you there? Harris, can you hear me? And he's like, who the fuck do you think you are? And I'm like, what? He goes, you think you're one of the pharaohs of Egypt? You think this dies with you? You think because it's hard work that you shouldn't be doing this? You think if you die like a pharaoh, all of your slaves have to be put to death and entombed in the pyramid with you? You get your ass back in there. You're doing a good thing. You keep it up. You're helping people. You hope so. You're helping Steve Gerber. You're going to get him a lung transplant. You can't let this go. Rah, 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 rah. And I'm like, I was scared to death. And Harris Miller kept it going, man. I mean, there was a time, and this was like 2 years into the organization. It was driving me nuts. But because Harris screamed at me and swore at me and compared me to one of the pharaohs of Egypt and accused me of being overly egocentric, which I might have been at that point, here we are.
Oh, man. You know, that is a great story.
Harris is one of those guys that, I mean, Harris has been he's been my representation since I was pretty young. I think was my second thing for Marvel. No, my second thing for DC was a Superman Batman book. And Walt Simonson said, you know, we're going to negotiate these contracts with DC. I said, we are. He goes, yeah, let me introduce you to my my contract lawyer, Harris Miller. I said, okay. And the first thing I thought was, I'm too small potatoes to be able to afford a lawyer. I mean, I was still living in an apartment or something. And, but whatever it was, I didn't think I could afford a lawyer. I'd never had one before. That seemed like a kind of a big boy pants thing. So, so Harris gets on the phone and he still represents me. But the thing is he doesn't always, do it for the money. He loves comics. He loves comics creators. And like you said, Steve Gerber, he's been there for so many creators over the years and done his part. So I can totally see how he was so irate with you because he's doing his version of it for a really long time. And it's not easy because he has to put up with me. You know, I wasn't always the elder statesman of comics that I am today. I was a real neurotic
young, very hyperactive person. And he had to put up with that, even when he didn't want to, but he stuck with it. So I just love that story because even a person like you had your moment of doubt and you overcame it. And look where we are. Look what you've done. You know. So my hat's off to you, Jim.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you. But again, I'll say and I mean this with all seriousness. It's everybody together. You know, I appreciate every time somebody wants to say, hey, thank you. But I go, no, thank you. And that's reality, man. That's how it is.
Dan, let's see that bottle again. That looks freaking awesome. Dude, Wiggle. The devil looks good, dude.
Which when you see that, you just get kind of like your mouth starts to kind of water and mm-hmm. you start getting up to, you know, thoughts that maybe aren't so good. so that's the back.
There's the heat right there. That's the boy that brings the heat. I love it.
My first Halloween costume, I wasn't even 2 years old. I was a devil.
That is so cool. You remember all the way back. That's freaking awesome.
It was a traumatic night, so I do remember parts of it, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Did you have one of those pitchforks?
My
those
mom
were classic.
I don't know if I did, but I was 23 months old. My mom penciled a mustache on me, and she said mm-hmm. that when I saw my face in the mirror with the mustache, I started crying.
Oh
yeah, but what I remember from my memory is going to my grandmother's house and my aunts. I had three aunts who were teenagers, and I didn't see them when I walked in the driveway. There was a kind of a cauldron, with these hags surrounding it, and steam coming out of the cauldron, which was probably dry ice. And they had their masks and their witch outfits, and they were cackling and telling me they were going to put me in the pot and cook me. And I thought I was going to die. And then they started talking to me in their aunt voices and their grandma voices and telling me it was okay. And it was just, you know, it was Halloween. And I still remember that. I think I carried that around with me, you know, and that explains a lot about me. And why I do what I do, and you know, and the trauma I had as a kid of I wasn't, you know, I was scared of the dark. I didn't like scary movies, and now, you know, look where I am now, doing Clive Barker comics or whatever I've done in the last 30 years. But yeah, I still remember that being in their driveway and having the crap scared out of me, for sure.
That's awesome. Like, but yeah, at the time, it probably was kind of scary for you, but it's a great story.
I think I got over it. I got over it, but the fact that I remember it, it must mm-hmm. have really been a big deal, you know, mm-hmm. to remember something from that far back. You know, I'll tell a little story, not about me, but about Gene Colan. Mm-hmm. When Gene Colan was 5 years old, it was 1939, and he wasn't drawing 4 books a month at that point. Not yet.
Only three.
Only three. He was ghosting under Adam Austin. So he's 5 years old, and his dad takes him to the movies. And the movie that they saw, he didn't know what they were going to see, but the movie that they saw completely discombobulated him for pretty much the rest of his life, and led to years and years of checking under the beds and in the closets, and they'd go to someone's house and stay over, and then they have to check their closets and under their beds. And that movie was Frankenstein.
Oh yeah. 1931. That was some of the most scariest stuff people had ever seen anywhere.
It was how out of left field is Frankenstein in 1939. And it's funny because people like my oldest son is almost 27, and his movie that freaked him out was the TV version of It, which his older sisters let him watch when I wasn't I was probably working or something, you know, in the studio, but his older sisters let him watch Tim Curry as as Pennywise, and you know, he was probably 9, you know, and it completely did him in. He didn't have anything to do with clowns or the circus or horror movies, nothing.
Good.
But then he watched The Shining a few years later, and he was like, you know, I couldn't handle that stuff as a kid. I think I saw
the Omega Man with Charlton Heston, and that put a spin on my head for about a year, and I was probably 9 at the time. But now that stuff is like my pablum, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm a kid. Got the my dad cared what we watched. My mom didn't care, and I rented that Texas Chainsaw Massacre. I must have been like 9 or 10, and I thought it was I thought it was actually pretty awesome.
You know, it's funny about that movie. It's not a gory film, really. It's just super disturbing. It's so atmospherically perfect. But I see, if I was 9 years old and I saw that movie, Leatherface would have haunted me for years and years and years. You know, I was already, I mean, I remember seeing the commercial for The Shining on TV when I was a kid, and that put a spin on my head. Maybe the worst trailer that really, really, really did me in when I was about 12 was for a film called Magic. Do you guys remember that movie with Anthony Hopkins?
You know, I think I do remember that
movie. He plays a magician and a ventriloquist. Wow. And he has this doll called Fats. And it's a great film. It's not really so much of a horror film. It's kind of a psychological horror film, but the trailer is maybe the scariest movie trailer of all time. And if you go on YouTube, check out the trailer for Magic, and it's what they showed on TV. And it got to the point, and it's basically the wooden doll comes on. He's this big. Hickory dickory dock. And he does this rhyme.
Mm-hmm.
And it's terrifying. And I was so messed up by it. And I was, you know, I was in probably seventh grade or eighth. I was in eighth grade. You know, I wasn't exactly like a little guy. I was so messed up, but I figured out when it came on TV so I could turn the TV off real quick. So I knew that it came on at 9:59 PM, you know, after the 9:30 show. And then just as it was turning 10 o'clock, they would show that on TV. And so I would get up to turn off the TV. And one time I got up to turn the TV off and it came on when I was a foot away from the TV screen. And that was it for me. But I didn't see that film until I was an adult. you know, it's no big deal. I read the book, you know, William Goldman. But it still doesn't beat Gene Colan and Frankenstein at 5 years old in 1939.
That makeup.
You know what I used to do something similar to that when Michael Jackson's Thriller came on, I was done. Couldn't
really. Really?
It's getting my God out of me.
Six years old, and you see, oh my God, the minute he turns around, oh, I'm done.
Yep.
Yeah, it's a frightening film. Thriller is frightening.
Very, very frightening. It's like when you hear, you know, when the video would come on, I would do the same thing as a kid. I would jump up and try to turn the TV, but the song is already in my head. The intro was so creepy. Yeah. I was in my head, and I'm traumatized for the rest of the day. Couldn't even
when Vincent Price started talking to you, he was talking to you, Sanford.
he was in my house looking in my bed. He was in my bedroom.
He was supposed to be a safe guy, and then he turns into a monster.
So at the end, when he turns around and he has those cat eyes.
Yeah.
When I was a child, like 4 years old, I would see that when I closed my eyes. I would see his cat eyes.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Oh.
That fucked me up.
Yeah, that's scary too. I mean, that whole devil eye thing at the end of any is always scary. I mean, I don't know if you remember a movie called Angel Heart.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
I saw that when I was like my first year of art school when it came out. But there's a scene where Lisa Bonet's little child, her little love child with Mickey Rourke, has that devil eye thing. And, you know, now it seems kind of hokey, but it, back then it was creepy. It was creepy. Yeah. It wasn't every other movie like it is now, but yeah.
I mean, I only, you know, as a kid, we only watched that movie so we can see Lisa Bonet, you know.
How old was she? What's that?
Priorities.
we didn't see the horror in it at the time. Scariness. We just saw Lisa Bonet. That's all we know.
You know, the thing that got me when I was a kid, there was a movie that came out called The Mysterious Monsters, and this was like a theatrical release, but it was supposed to be a movie that told you the truth about Bigfoot and the Loch Ness Monster and the Abominable Snowman and all this stuff.
Right.
And I would see these commercials on TV. And I knew, even as like, even at 8 years old, I know like, yeah, Frankenstein's not real. Dracula's not real. But Bigfoot seemed real and scary. Loch Ness Monster seemed real and scary. And here's this movie and I'm seeing these TV commercials and they make it seem so real. And they're going to tell you the truth and everything like that. And they show you this spooky footage of like Bigfoot walking down a street in what looks like my freaking neighborhood. And I remember that just scared the hell out of me. I remember I had this dream one night when I was a kid. I was like 8 years old that I dreamed that somehow Bigfoot was in our house. And every time I tried to tell my parents in the dream, it's like, oh my God, Bigfoot's in the house. Let's get out of here. He's going to kill us or do whatever Big Feet do. I was so scared I couldn't talk. It's like the words would not come out of my mouth. And this dream was so petrifying. I remember the next night, you know, my mom, I wouldn't tell my parents I didn't want to go to sleep because I was afraid I was going to have the same dream. I was afraid I was going to pick up the same dream. And I never told my parents what was going on, but my mom had definitely twigged on to, okay, he's upset about something. My mom sat there at like the kitchen table, like playing crazy eights with me, playing cards with me until like 2 a.m. I'm 8 years old and I'm up till 2 a.m. because I'm scared to death to go to bed. My mom is finally like, you know what, kid, I love you, but that's enough. It's like, I'm tired, you're tired, get to bed, what's going on? And it's like, oh, I dreamed about Bigfoot. And she's like, it's just a movie. No, it's real. It's like,
real.
It's just a movie. It's like,
shoot, I'm still afraid of Big Feet, Bigfoot monster, and all that.
No one wants to mess with, and now all the Bigfoot movies, he's like a, you know, he's a savage homicidal maniac. You know, when we were kids, Jim, when we were kids, it was the, you know, remember the legend of Buggy Creek about the Arkansas folk monster was like, we saw that in the drive-in. Those were kind of grindhouse drive-in films that you would see. And I remember just completely buying it hook, line and sinker. Every aspect of Bigfoot, and Bigfoot was huge in the 70s.
Yeah.
He was America's monster.
You know? Hell, I even remember, I'd never read the Thomas Harris books. I'd never read Red Dragon or anything like that. But I remember when I saw The Silence of the Lambs, when it came out in movie theaters, you know, again, I've never been scared of Jason and Friday the 13th, you know, the hack slash stuff, whatever. It's too hokey. But that just seems so real. It's like, okay, here's a real psycho who is very smart and very seductive and can get into your brain. I remember when that came out, I was like 21 years old. Me and my roommate, we go to the movies, we see it, we come home. And usually at the end of the night, whatever, we watch the 10 o'clock news. Then there's like a Cheers rerun and like a MASH rerun. Then whatever, we, you know, we go off to bed. So we're sitting there and we're like watching this. And, you know, we're sitting on two different couches. And I tell my roommate, it's like, yeah, man, head off to bed if you want. You know, I think I'm going to sit here and watch some more TV. It's like, yeah, I think I'll sit here as well. So we watch like a Star Trek rerun. And then we watch like, I don't know, whatever rerun is on after that. And all of a sudden it's 1 a.m. And I finally look at him and go, okay, man, I'll admit it. I was freaked out by that damn movie. I'm scared. What do you say we go to the hall closet, we get those extra blankets, we both sleep here in the living room on the couches with like the extra blankets. He's like, you have a deal, but let's walk through the closet together to get the blankets. I'm like, okay.
20.
I mean, that's how much that freaked me out at 21.
Yeah, yeah. When you're alone in the house, you should not watch any kind of movies like that if you have an overactive imagination, because I swear, like, I check the doors, I make sure, you know, everything's locked, and you know, it's, it doesn't matter that you know logically that that stuff is not real.
It's like,
you know?
I checked that door 5 minutes ago. Let's see if it's still locked.
Yeah. I have one of my kids is 9 and he's going through this this scary monster at night thing that it reached a fever pitch about a month ago. And he just, you know, he would come in 3 or 4 times. We're trying to watch, you know, our shows at the end of the night. And he comes in and I said, you know, what, can you just tell me, what is your biggest fear? What is the thing that really scares you the most? I mean, just let's go there for a second. And he says, that a monster is going to come in and eat me. I go, really? And you know, monsters aren't real. He goes, it doesn't matter. When he's in bed, you know, and it's dark, monsters are totally real. And they're going to come and eat him. And I said, you know, they're going to eat your brother first. Listen, he's on the lower bunk. He's so much easier to get. And you're going to hear that.
And when you hear that, you'll have time to get away. So you're going to be fine.
Dude, I mean, father of the year right there.
We tried so many different ways to explain to him that it was all in his head. I mean, you know, oh, it's makeup. It's none of that matters. When you're scared, you're scared. That's it. Doesn't matter. Oh, yeah. Hannibal Lecter is really Anthony Hopkins. Doesn't matter. He's outside. He's outside waiting for you to go to sleep.
Anthony Hopkins being outside is actually almost freakier. Like, if Anthony Hopkins was hanging out outside my house, I'd be a little concerned.
Yeah, especially if you're looking up at your window, like he could see.
And if he does that tongue thing, like...
Well, see, you know, Becky, you say that, and then Anthony Hopkins will go over to Megan's house next.
When you talked about your...
We could take him.
Hell yeah.
Becky and I are, we're athletic enough that we could just, like, fucking take that dude down.
I'm really short. I'm going to, like, crouch down, trying to knock one him off balance.
Yeah, no.
That's how you have to, you have to get mad at it. You have to get mad at the fear. That's how you kind of have to. I think that's why I created the Nocturnals, because there's a bunch of monster characters that live at night during the nighttime, and they kick the shit out of the monsters. And so anytime you're watching some film where these people are completely all thumbs when it comes to surviving, and they stand there and they cry while the monster comes up to them and does whatever he does, Michael Myers comes and kill you. Michael Myers should be so easy to get away from. And so I always think, man, if one of my characters was in there, he'd fuck their shit up, you know? And that actually was very cathartic for me, I think, even as an adult having, you know, I think that's why I love comics. That's why I love superheroes and even Man-Thing. Because Man-Thing was okay as long as you weren't scared of him. But comics, superheroes are always beating up monsters. And I think that's one of the things, that's what saved my childhood is Marvel Comics, you know?
I think you're onto something, man, because... I don't know. Recently, I'm not a scary movie person, but my book is about, you know, demonic spirits and all kinds of, you know, stuff similar to that. And because I'm already immersed in that world, like my mind, I have control because my characters will, like you said, they will just put a new one in these, you know, monsters or whatever.
Yeah.
And so... There are certain things that I used to be like, oh, I don't want to see that. Now I'm kind of like the tolerance and the sensitivity is on another level because I got this thing that I've already created in my own psychosis, I guess, to you know, like, oh, yeah, you know, I remember that film that scared the living crap out of me for 30 years. But now it's kind of like, oh, yeah, I'm you know, you're just in a different headspace with it. So, yeah, you're onto something with that, man.
Your imagination created well, it's like I told my son, Shane, I said, listen, if you can imagine the worst monster in the world coming and eating you, and he loves to draw comics and all these characters and stuff. I said, you can imagine a hero who will beat the crap out of that monster for you, you know? So, I mean, you know that you can do that. You can orient your imagination to whatever. And it really is, you know, a freeing thing to be able to match that in your imagination, even whether it's supernatural or real people, you know, just to not be afraid. To not be afraid is the toughest thing to kind of get over that hurdle, you know. So this, this is getting deep for drink and draw.
the moral of the story is, if you want to overcome your fears, create a superhero.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, even if you're just a comic book reader or a fan, or you're not an artist or a writer necessarily, but if you could, I mean, I think that's the touchstone. Batman is the touchstone because he's this creature of darkness who's there in the dark with you to help you out. And maybe he's not real. Maybe he's not going to be there when you're walking down the street at night. But at least you can know that you shouldn't be afraid, you know? Which is easy to say when you're safe in your house, but you know, I've lived in the city. I had to walk places when I was younger, at night in the city, and I just developed an attitude that I was going to be okay, and I was, luckily. I didn't walk around scared of people, you know, which I don't know, and depending on where you are, that's a luxury, and sometimes it's a good thing. Mm-hmm. But
yeah, I agree with what Sanford said. I just shout Shazam and hope the lightning bolt strikes. Get some of that power, you know. Or, you know, you'll just get electrocuted. Then I'll take you off the map.
We all have one power. Most of us, we can run.
Mm-hmm.
At top speed.
You got to watch out for those branches on the ground, though. Don't have one of those trips.
Get them all. Make sure your car is going to start when you go to start it.
Get the oil changed.
Don't trip on the leaf when you're running away from the bad guy and he's crawling towards you and you're running top speed. Don't trip over a leaf, or a twig.
Make sure you're faster than your friends.
Yes.
Hey, we got a little visitor over there.
Yeah.
Oh, we got another puppy.
Yeah, this is Bats. I have to take her outside to go pee and poop. So
is that a beagle?
Yes.
Yeah, this is Bats, named after the Doctor Strange ghost dog.
Cool.
Mm-hmm. She's a pain in the ass.
Yeah, she's a monster.
But I should run. Also, one of my coasters, actually a couple of my coasters got bent in half. So, Jim, if you want me to redraw the one that I had to use, I will.
Okay. I sent you a couple of extras, right?
Yeah, they, like half of them got fucked up, so.
Oh, well.
Honestly, it's our mail because I was also telling them that, like, we live in the woods. And so I think that, like, by the time they get out here, they're like, fuck these people and just throw packages at our house.
Oh, yeah.
So you sent us seven and three of my coasters were folded in half. So
we'll check it out. We'll see what happens.
Okay. But if it's too damaged, I'll redraw it. So
cool.
All right.
Megan, thank you so much for joining us tonight.
This was so fun. Thank you. And it's so good to see you guys.
It's good to see you.
People, places. Becky, we live down the street from each other. We should probably hang out.
Thank you.
I miss
Donny,
you.
Thank you so much for coming by. You were the best co-host I've ever had, my brother. My Texas brother right there.
I'm not going to let him, because he will keep talking. So I'm going to.
I'm
You'll talk to him tomorrow.
All right. Hey, really nice talking to you guys. Absolutely.
Right. Bye, guys.
And I'll see you in the morning for segment a nice thing.
That's it. The King in Black coming tomorrow. Absolutely. 1 Eastern, 12 noon Central. Be there, be square.
Thank you, guys. That was awesome.
Thanks so much.
Take care.
I think I'm gonna get out of here.
Show off my last two, and I'm going to be heading off as well.
It is getting kind of late, Jim, isn't it?
Warlock.
I think it is. Whoa, that's great, man.
And Frankenstein.
Excellent.
That was great. Yep. I finished up my Zatanna. She's done.
Awesome.
And my death here.
Wow. Awesome.
That's a great expression.
Thank you.
I'm in the world's best friend.
Got, what is that? Boom Boom.
Oh, hell yeah.
Oh, nice.
Miles. Catwoman.
Nice.
What's his name? Buddha?
That was great.
Color on some of these, but I know that I'm not going to get any of that done now. But I will, Jim. I'll do color.
Do whatever you do. You guys are the artistes.
Sweet.
I can't do what you do.
Jim, when you say artiste, I get like chills.
Should.
Thanks for putting this together, man. And everybody for joining in.
Yeah, it was great to spend the evening with you guys.
Honestly, this is a good time.
And thanks for everybody who supported Hero Initiative. You're doing a great thing. You're all mensches. You're okay.
I didn't realize it was almost 11:30. That's what happens when you are in good company.
I'm flying. Yes.
Yeah, I gotta go.
Well, good company.
And time.
Enjoy the rest of the evening, everybody.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, go. Take care, you guys. Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody. This was a lot of fun.
Bye, everybody.
Take care, everyone.
I guess we'll go look at a scary movie.
Not too scary.
It is October 23rd. But yeah, not too scary.
Yes, sir.
And Jim, you can we always have extra blankets and pillows in our closet. So just so you know, you're always welcome.
You know what? Okay? We got to walk to that closet together.
That's a quote right there. We'll walk to that closet together.
We were too afraid to walk to the damn hall closet alone.
I love that.
All right, guys. Vaya con Dios.
Vaya con Dios, everybody.
Right, thanks, everybody. Thanks for putting this together. Here's the last sketch I finished up.
Oh, beautiful. Beautiful, man.
Throwing some color on there. Getting crazy with the color. I like it.
Everybody have a good night. See you guys.
You too, Sean. Take care.
You too.
Dan, thank you so much. Have a great night. Take care.
Good night, everybody. Thanks so much for having me.
Well, fans, this has been the Hero Initiative Drink and Draw 2020. This was an excellent freaking fun time here at BaltimoreComicCon.com. One of the best places I've ever been since last year was Baltimore Comic Con here virtually. I want to thank everyone in the chat, everyone that came out, everyone that supports the Hero Initiative, donated to the Hero Initiative. You will be getting your coasters in the mail very soon from Jim at the Hero Initiative. Again, what a night we've had. I want to thank Wiggle Whiskey, the best distillery in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And man, just an amazing night. But for everyone here at BaltimoreComicCon.com, BaltimoreComicCon.com, BaltimoreComicConLive.com, the HeroInitiative.org, and Wiggle Whiskey, and all of our superstar artists that we've had here tonight on the show. And hey, you know, Ryan Stegman couldn't make it, but we got one of the greats in Donny Cates. Fans, this is the great legend saying peace out. God bless.